and a half. Let's go over to our man, Mr. Teddy Kekstadt, as you do each and every Wednesday at 40 past the hour. You can reach Teddy every trading day at forex-trading-unlocked.com. And bottom line, folks, is that we're laying at these levels and have been laying at these levels, man, for a long time. Teddy Kekstadt, what's going on, brother?
Good morning, guys.
How you doing? Good
morning, Teddy.
Pretty crazy. We got the dollar was pretty strong this morning, coming back a little bit since the stock market opened. So, but the pound and the Canada and the Australian dollar are definitely giving the dollar a surge today.
Yeah, you know, I guess, and when I look at the pound, like, and that's a normal pullback, I guess, for, you know, we've had a couple signs of strength, man. But what I'd like you to do is get on the telephone, man, and tell some people to stop buying that pound so the dollar will crash.
Well, the Swiss is doing the parity dance, so the dollar right now seems to be holding its strength right now. I don't think, you know, no matter what, we've been talking about this for weeks now, it seems that the dollar, no matter what, it's holding strong with the news and with the way the interest rates are going.
Yes.
And I was actually down by the Board of Trade yesterday talking to some guys, and it seems like with the rollover now, it's really tough to trade the interest rates and looking how the currencies are going. I think we're going to see a lot of neutral trading, like the euro and the U.S. The euro U.S. dollar trade has been in basically a $2 range now for months.
Okay.
You know, so, and nobody sees that even remotely changing, you know, especially with the Brexit thing and the way the EU looks like right now with their economic numbers. Now, there is a sleeping catalyst that could change things, and that is the Turkish lira. With right now, with what's going on with them with Syria and with our U.S. potential military issues, if we start to put on sanctions or make some kinds of moves, the Turkish lira could take a dive, and that could actually start to cause some instability and also affect the euro as well.
Interesting, yeah. So, this yen, man, this yen just is, it's weak, rather, but it seems like it's loving this 111 point, man, you know?
It is. It just keeps on trying to butt up against this 112 even area. It doesn't seem to want to hold above it, which is a pretty key psychological area.
Yeah. Because I'm actually surprised that the dollar is actually not up more, this morning we had that spike. But because, like, once it starts with 111, it's like, well, you want 114 again? What do you want here? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like...
Right. Well, that's the one thing that's interesting about the dollar strength right now, especially over the past couple days. Except for the pound, you're not getting it from your major, pieces of the pie. You're getting it from more of your outlying currencies. Like, the Australian dollar is just getting smashed.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Canadian dollar is just rallying like a balloon underwater, you know. So the pound, relatively, this pullback is kind of, I wouldn't say it's indicative of what's going on with the dollar. It's more of just a little bit of a profit-taking break, you know. So, and I think that one of the things, like especially like I mentioned, the Turkish lira, you have this situation with Syria, and now you also have the turnover of power in Mexico, too, to Lopez Obrador, I believe.
Okay.
Now, that could be a threat to NAFTA and totally change the peso-dollar trade. Most people, we don't talk about the peso usually very often, but up until this point, we were looking at NAFTA being resolved between Canada, Mexico, and the United States.
Yeah.
An amicable agreement that definitely is better than what was in place before. And it was also something that was good to keep the peso relatively stable, where it's been trading around basically 17 to 22 pesos to the dollar for years now, in that kind of a range, which is seems to be pretty healthy. It's good for American tourists, that's for sure.
Yes.
You know,
we never get into this, but Teddy, how did you get in the foreign currency business?
How did I get in the foreign currency business? It really started as being a bond trader, an interest rate trader. And
okay.
I didn't trade the futures because of the liquidity issues, especially with overnight trades and stuff.
Yes.
And where you could trade the night bonds and things like that at the time when I first started trading. And then with the advent of the cash market, once the broker, because originally the cash market was all broker dealers. You had to have a lot of money to participate. No even reasonably sizable retail trader or institutional trader could even touch that market.
Yes.
Once that opened up in 1998, and I saw that one, you could trade them 24 hours a day. That was okay. Now I didn't have that risk of when the bonds were closed, so I started using the currency cash with the interest rates, and then that's how I got
into that.
Nice.
Because it's, folks, what happens if you're interested in the currency market, the way I would do it is to take one currency at a time. Because it took me a while to get acclimated to it. Do you know what I mean? But it's so intriguing, man, because it's almost, what I like about it is like it's like a commodity market. You only can go so far down. There are fundamentals in between that. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
And knowing the currencies are like, wow, man, you know, that's the world we live in, man. And I can imagine, you know, when before the euro came into being, I'd say all those European traders, they had to know currency upside down. It's like you're going from state to state, right? And, you know, you got to know, what's my money worth today, right?
Yes, compared to what, right? Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. Could you imagine trying to plan your travel when you're going from one country to the next on your vacation?
Exactly. No, exactly.
Yeah, you need 15 different.
You know, like
yeah.
You're doing well when you're in France, and then you're doing really bad when you're in Italy the next week. You know?
No, totally. And what's really cool about it, you can see why people can have currency battles too. Because if you can have a nice weak currency, you're going to get bigger volume.
Well, now you just hit the nail on the head there, currency battle. And I think that that is something that we're going to see come this summertime.
Okay.
Now think about the trade war talks and how they've disengaged the tariffs for now and whatever. And, you know, we know that this is going to get hashed out eventually. But one thing that is definitely done, as you know, as well as I do, guys, markets correct. And they don't wait for governments and whoever else to make a decision on what they're going to do.
Right.
You know. So, and we've seen, especially over the last 6 to 8 months, an explosion in growth in manufacturing outside of China.
Okay.
We have an explosion of manufacturing in the U.S. where we're relying on things that do come out of Asia that we were going to get, that we were getting from China, that now we're not getting from China. And there's a double-edged thing happening here. You have the yuan U.S. dollar trade, which nobody really talks about because the yuan is so fixed. However, the fact is that it's the way the dollar has been moving in that relation with that, it's actually hurting the Chinese right now. So their exports are getting more and more expensive.
Okay.
Everyone knows the quality is horrible. And now you have people in this country that are in business that are now, wait, our loss leader and parts problems are no longer as big of an issue with our new suppliers. So do you think that they're going to go back now if they're getting parts from Vietnam or Taiwan or India and go back to their Chinese supplier, which was they were losing money on, no matter what the trade deal is?
That's wild. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, so, and if that's the case, it doesn't matter how this trade deal works out. We may be seeing the beginning of where their economy is solely based in-house because the rest of the world has had pretty much enough with the fixed currencies and the bad products. And they know that they keep growing and buying stuff up everywhere else. And it's all on based off of debt and what have you, you know.
It's gonna be wild watching this thing shake up.
Yeah, that's a big one.
Because there's no doubt you never want to lose an order. I mean, if you lose an order and someone else can come in and fill it, and the person's happy with it or the company's happy, it's a problem.
Don't lose them all. Right. That's for sure.
You see what happens, right, guys?
Right.
Teddy, you have a great week, safe week, stay warm. We look forward to speaking to you next Wednesday.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Teddy.
Appreciate it.
And folks, you can check out Teddy every trading day. Forex-trading-unlocked.com. Down on 56.85, NASDAQ up 44, S&P down 13. Tommy and I come right back.